Hello, and welcome to the new edition of Italic Calligraphy and Handwriting. You know, writing and printing are subordinate to spoken language. The spoken language came millions of years before writing was ever invented. And writing must have looked very queer to people when they first saw it, especially the alphabetic writing. It was as late as 1500 BC that alphabetic writing first appeared. Now, if I say verba volant scripta manent, you can say, hey, how about that? What was it you said? But I can write it out, and you can read it several times, and I don't have to repeat it. However, if it is written illegibly, there is no chance of asking the writer what he meant by it, and you may have to wait a long time to see what the intention of the thing was. Another weird thing about writing and about printing, about the graphic representation of speech, is that speech vanishes once it is uttered. You see, speech comes from the interior, from the mind and the heart, God knows what, and it comes out, the verba volant. The word flies is what that means. It flies and it disappears. It's gone. Whereas it's in time, completely in time. Whereas writing, you see, is in space. And this has incredible consequences as far as our learning to write, learning the art of the scribe is concerned. The peculiar thing about the writing is that the four words here are before you all at once. In speaking, there's only one sound going into your ears at any one fraction of a second. It's flying. This stays. The scripta or writing, manet, it stays. And it's a great advantage for much of our literature is literature because it is letters. Because it has been written out first, after it has been verbalized probably, and then put into printing types. One of the fascinating things about this design in space, and by the way, we're all designers. Whenever we pen a note to the milkman, even though it may be scrawled, if you just make a touch on a piece of paper with a pencil, you've marked that rectangle and the design has already begun. So we're working in space and we have to design these movements of the pen. The pen moves and it moves through time, but it moves through space too. And writing and printing involve more white paper than they do ink. In fact, there's a very tiny percentage of ink on any page of writing or of printing. It's mostly paper, and this paper has to be designed, and it is designed by the pen as it designs the letters. So one of the things I would have you watch when you learn to write is to watch the shape of the paper that you're outlining, that you're circumscribing, because that will make the reading legible, make it readable. The readable is legibility that is more pleasurable. Now, the writing here has thick and thin contrasts and gradations. The ancient writing tool was a stick, a pointed stick, and it was only in the second century, or third century maybe, BC, that the Romans cut the pen across, producing an edge. Now, the incredible thing about this wonderful tool, Edward Johnson says it's the letter-making tool, is that edge, that very thin edge. It's almost non-existent. All the rest of the pen exists merely for the sake of holding on to it. The important thing is that edge. And what is most important for you when you're learning to write, first learning to write, is your control of that edge. And this is what I mean by the control of the edge. That you have horizontal, a vertical and horizontal axes on a page. Now, bisect that 90-degree angle. Bisect it with a hairline. The edge of the pen must always be exactly on that 45-degree angle. You cannot vary it this way, you cannot vary it that way. It must always be steep like that. So watch this more than anything else. At the very beginning, pay no attention to much else except that angle. Now we take the letter I, which is one of the letters we'll take today. We go into it at a 45-degree angle, and that gives us a fine line. turning here is we get the thickest stroke of the pen. This is a little thinner. It gets thicker here and then goes into an almost invisible hairline because the edge of this pen is held at a 45 degree angle to the writing line. It's edge, always edge, that we have to bear in mind. Take a letter like the N. It's a subtle letter. It looks relatively easy, but it is one of the most important and most difficult letters that we have to learn. We go in at a 45 degree angle with that edge. The edge produces the thinness here. It produces all of the effects. They're entirely due to that delicate and wonderful, narrow, almost non-existent edge of the pen. But watch that edge. Now, if you get the edge too flat, see what happens to that N I had up there. It becomes an intolerably ugly design. You simply cannot see it as anything at all. If the pen is too steep, it's all head and it's all feet. There's no design to it. These are utterly impossible. But get in between those. Here the pen angle was flat. Here it is too steep. So get a 45 degree pen angle. Now don't be concerned with much else until your hand learns at all times to produce that 45 degree angle of the edge. The pen must be frozen in your hand so the edge is up steep. You may think I repeat this almost too much here at the beginning, but I couldn't repeat it too much, and we'll be insisting on it throughout the early parts of this program, this series of lessons. That edge must be steep. Now, that is the first lesson in a series of three stages in your writing. Now, let's see what those stages are. In writing, as in learning to do anything, in learning to cut down a tree, in learning to handle a plane, in learning to play golf, to swim, handle a tennis racket, you have to know what the idea is. So first of all, let's get the idea. Get the idea starts everything. A man may say to a kid with an axe in his hand, "Hey, what do you think you're doing?" Or with a hammer, holding the hammer incorrectly, "What do you think you're doing?" It means the kid doesn't have the idea. You have to get the idea before you can get the next stage, which is the feel. The feel of the thing, the feel of writing, the sensation of touch, the sensation of movement. And this is going to be all wrong if this is wrong. So read the text, read it over and over, and understand what you are attempting to do, and then get the image of touch and of movement into your fist. Once it's in your fist can do the writing. You think a certain phrase, you say, "Hand, go to it." Your hand will write it out. Now, when that happens, you're in for the most exciting part of this, which is getting the swing of it. And when you once get this, you're starting to be a writer. You get the swing of it. Do you remember that old song, "It don't mean a thing if it ain't got that swing"? The swing is the rhythm. And once you get the rhythm, then you're really moving. And writing is movement in space. Now, this element of space is very important because we have to design in space. So let's look at the beginning of plate one in the book. We have a writing line. We have a waistline, which is just above the writing line. We have an ascender line above that. Now, we have descender line. The P descends down to the descender line, which is also an ascender line for the B, which is on the next writing line. So when I refer to writing line, waistline, ascender line, you know what I mean. Halfway between the waistline and the ascender line is the cap line, or the line of the capital letters. 6 and 8 go up that high. 3, 4, 5, and 9 come halfway down to the descender line. Now, how big should a letter be? You'll notice on plate one, these squares marked in here. Now, those squares are marks of the pen with the edge held absolutely vertically. A letter in italic has a body height of 5 widths of the pen. So you see, I'm measuring the widths of the pen here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Now, with your T-square, you draw the writing line horizontally, you draw the waistline horizontally, you'd mark the same distance up above here, and draw the ascender line, you'd mark the same distance down below, 5 pen widths, and draw the descender line. Some letters are made with single strokes, others with double strokes. There are 20 letters made without lifting the pen in rapid italic, and there are 6 letters which are made with one making one pen lift. Now, the letter slope is only 5 degrees off the vertical. I wish you'd go over 2 with your pen. Get this pen set. Get a set that has, as it's called, a lettering set. It has pens from fine widths to medium and so on to B, and then to B2, B3, and B4. Now, we start our work with the widest nib in order that we can see what our mistakes are, and then gradually, as the lessons proceed, we'll work down to the smaller nibs so that it will be of use in letter writing, writing a check, or in writing out small booklets. Now, with that pen, with the broad nib in and no ink in the pen, let your pen match that edge up here and match the white line, and pull down according to the directions given in these hairpin strokes, and get the shape and the order and direction of the stroke. The order and direction of the stroke are extremely important in all cultures, Chinese, Hebrew, Arabic, as well as the Roman alphabets used in Roman history. And it's extremely important that you move in a certain direction and in a certain order. Now, our basic form in italic is an ellipse. First, I want you to write an ellipse with a pencil. You see the guidelines are here. Start just a little before 11, come down, and draw a circle in perspective. That is, you turn a slope a circle a little bit, and then turn it so that the width is a little over half the height, and you have the outside edge of the O. This is an ellipse, or a circle in perspective. So I'll write an O at 5 pen widths, and the outside, no, this is more than 5. The outside edge is an ellipse. Now, this appears in A, D, G, Q, B, P, C, O, and E, and the effect of that is felt in all the letters that have entrances and exits, because this is related to the ellipse. The shoulder with its curving is related to the ellipse. So is the exit related to the ellipse. So I would like to have you do about half a page, pardon me, in pencil of I, O, I, O, I, O, and then do the bottom 2 lines in I, O with an edged pen. Now fold a piece of typing paper, 8.5 by 11, use bond paper. Don't use erasable bond or onion skin paper. But take this sheet out of the back of the book that has a B4 down in the corner. The first line up here shows you the 5-degree letter slope. The second, the pen angle. So you can check your pen angle by that line. Then fold the paper over, and then with your pencil, do OI, 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 and then with the pen, write OIs and OIs. And that will be enough for the assignment for the first lesson. Let's write the O again, or the I and O. I recommend that you use black ink and put only ordinary fountain pen ink in your pen. Don't put carbon-based ink in, because the carbon may clog the pen. There's the I, the O. Now let's put an N on it. Add an N with these ellipses. The L is very simple. You put the pen down with the edge at a 45-degree angle to the writing line, and then just pull from the shoulder if you have to, then make this narrow elliptical exit. We can write a number of words if we have these few letters. Rather important concept in our present time. The word that I like most to write with this combination, though, is, whoops, I caught some fiber in that paper. There's that. So with four letters, you can get a lion. There's a wonderful old story, a very ancient one, about the mother lion looking at her little cubs. They're born, and the cub is amorphous. He has no shape to him at all. He's just a honey-colored ball. And with tender, loving care, she licks him into shape. And by licking him delicately and carefully, she finally comes out with a lion. And that is more or less what you have to do in the writing, is use the pen as if you were caressing the paper. And you caress with tender, loving care these letter forms onto the paper. Don't go straight down on the paper and attacking it viciously, but go down very lightly, gradually. Come up off the paper very gradually like that. Go down slantendicular, as they used to say. And come off very gradually. That'll get a very fine hairline. Down onto it, the O, just before 11 and just before 5, you lift it, if that were a clock dial, complete it. And then the N, a very delicate touch. It doesn't take much pressure. You have only enough pressure to leave a trail of ink. But try to use your wrist. See, we don't write with finger motion. We don't write rotating our arm and the big muscle of the forearm. I'll talk to you later about the origin of this. This is very interesting. This is no way to write, and it was invented very late. Writing with the fingers will give you finger cramp. And after you've written for a couple of hours, you'll have difficulty just peeling your fingers up off the barrel of the pen. They'll be rigid on the pen, and it hurts. It's very painful. I think that the reason that forearm writing was invented was that in the 18th century, people had forgotten how writing had been done traditionally. I'm sure writing had been done moving the whole hand on a free wrist, the whole hand on a free wrist. You need a flexible wrist to do this. I've had students with arthritis who said it helped their arthritis in their wrists greatly by learning to write with this wrist movement. And the medical school physical therapy department said this was an awfully good exercise for arthritic wrists. But this is the way writing was done. But they forgot it. They wrote with their fingers. And then in the 18th century, in order to solve the problem of finger cramp in the business offices, the writing masters invented writing on the big muscle of the forearm. And of course, you don't get hand cramp that way. But the design of the alphabet was ruined. And that's one reason we have the commercial cursive designs, which we suffer so much through the third grade at the present time. The designs are really degraded forms of this Italian Renaissance script, which we call Italic, after the Italians, where it was invented. It was invented around 1401, 1402, and it disappeared finally because of business uses, but it's been revived in this present century, and its popularity is increasing rapidly in Europe, especially in England. Well, Belgium, Germany, especially East Germany, Sweden has it as the only handwriting in the schools. And in Oregon here, it is a possible handwriting. It's authorized as an official handwriting system in case there's a teacher who is interested in it and can teach it. So in the remaining time, let's watch some writing. Thank you. When I write, I wish you would try to identify with my hand. Imagine it's your hand and see if you can imagine the sensations of touch and movement as my hand goes over the surface of the paper. Make it your hand in imagination. And then when the program's over, take the paper and your pens and try the same thing, only watch the edge. The edge is everything. You take a complex letter like, which we won't take for a while yet, but this one. If you drew that, it would take you forever. But you can write it in just a moment. The printer's form of it is somewhat different. It uses less space. Not as beautiful, I think. But to draw that would be an awful job. But you can write it, or you can write the more rapid version very quickly. Let's see. Will you notice, please, that I go rather rapid on the hairline, slow on the heavy strokes, much slower on the heavy strokes than on the hairline. There is very little pressure on these downstrokes, these six strokes. There is much less pressure on the hairlines. Barely touch the paper. And then a little pressure, very little, just enough to leave a trail of ink. And on all these hairlines, this one, the branching, and this one, we're almost off the paper. This branching, by the way, is like the branching on a tree. The branch comes out very gradually, moves out into space. And halfway between the writing line and the waistline, if you look in the inner part of the letter, the counter, as we call it, you'll see that branch leaves the stem about halfway between the writing line and the waistline. So when you try and then watch that branching. We have a reverse branching, and a typical letter is the U. A U should look like an N upside down. See, it branches in halfway up, or if you turn it over, it's an N, and it's branching out halfway up. You can stand on your head and write a U, and it's a good N. You can stand on your head and write an N, and it makes a good U. M is like the N, branching out halfway up. The A has the reverse branching like the U. So when you start with N, the critical thing is that hairline branch going in there. Suppose your pen angle is too flat. You don't get a hairline branching in there. You see how ugly that is? You need another kind of italic. It's a more formal italic, and the branching isn't the same at all. The end is a completely different end. Now, if you cannot get a steep pen angle, you'll have to write that italic. You can't base a handwriting on it, though. It's impossible. It's just too heavy. You can't join into the next letter. See, the beauty of the steep pen angle, and one of the reasons for its invention, is that you make a hairline join, which is almost invisible, into the next letter. One of the weak things about commercial cursive is that there's no difference in the line between the join and between the letter. And you can't tell with the letter where the letter begins or where it ends because much of it is joined. Here, the letters tend to stand out and be unique. We join out of the middle of the E like that, the two-stroke E. And the hairline should be virtually invisible. We don't use joins with letters this big. With medium nibs or fine nibs, we can use the join and it'll be okay. But in order to anticipate the handwriting, which we're going to do later, the rapid handwriting with the small nibs, you'll have to watch this 90-degree angle, which is bisected by the edge of the pen. Everything depends on your consciousness all the time at the beginning of the nature of this edge. So don't think of much else in the first few times you're working with the pens until it becomes a habit. You must remember to get that edge up steep like that. When we work with the majuscules or the caps, the pen angle is a little flatter, but not for the minuscule, and for all rapid handwriting, a steep pen angle.